Welcome to the funeral service for Peter Duyck. On behalf of Peter's family, thank you for being here, both in person and online. It is appreciated. This service is not just a formality or something that people ought to do, though this is true. It's a gathering to remember and reflect, and it's an essential part of what goes on. It's essential for several reasons. Grief is essential for healthy living. The world is broken and chaotic, and we experience loss in many ways. We each need to grieve well, or we will be hindered from living well. Grief is healthy and an essential part of life. Second, relationships are essential for healthy living. We need each other more than we usually acknowledge, and certainly more than we act on. We are created for deep, meaningful, and growing connection with God and each other. It is to our own detriment when we neglect relationships and gathering together. We are healthier when we do life together. And finally, gratitude and thankfulness are essential. Often we in North America want to jump to this one, make it only a celebration of life without going through the grief and engaging in relationship. We also tend to rush gratitude and thankfulness even in the whole process. Remembering and being thankful for what we have lost can be painful, but it is also the path to really appreciating the impact that someone has had on our life. To rush to or rush through gratitude and thankfulness prevents us from examining our own lives and taking hold of what has been meaningful, allowing ourselves to be changed. All these three, grief, relationship, gratitude, are all interconnected. To rush through any of these is to miss the opportunity to grow and mature through fully experiencing this loss. And it distorts future connections. Much like rebound dating leads to unhealthy choices, so too it is unwise to fill our lives with things too soon and rush through grief and relationship and remembering and giving thanks. So I encourage each one to make time to process this loss and realign with who you are created to be. Then you will move forward toward greater health and wholeness. One of the best ways to reflect and realign is through music. Music can touch a whole person, especially when the lyrics are full of truth. I want to open with a word of prayer, and then Kalia, granddaughter, will sing Amazing Grace. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for life. Thank you for eternal life that you've made possible, Jesus. We thank you for Peter's life and the impact he's had. I pray for each one here, each person. You would comfort them. You would help them grieve well. Even when it's awkward, we would push into relationship and have growing relationships. And thus, we would celebrate, we would remember and give gratitude well, having gone through these journeys. Please be in this service and make it meaningful part of this process for each one here. We ask in your name. Amen. Now, his granddaughter Kalia will sing Amazing Grace, and that'll be followed by the eulogy by Linda.
Good morning. I'm Linda. I'm one of Pete's many nieces that he has. Today we're here to celebrate Uncle Pete, his life and memories of your dear father, your grandfather, your brother, your uncle, and a friend. Uncle Pete was born in Mexico, but raised in Canada in the community of Ganantal, Manitoba. He started working at the age of 14 as a potato harvester to help his parents with his young siblings. Uncle Pete met Aunt Lynn. They got married and they moved to Vancouver. The adventure was about to begin. He got a job in a factory building tugboats. He also helped build a submarine for an actor named Woody Allen. It was not long before they moved north to Prince George, where he went to college and he got his GED. This is the time that Trish was born. And guess what? I remember that. It was not long after they moved their little family to the town of Vanderhoof. that he got a job in the local mill. Missing home from Manitoba, they moved back for a short time, but landed up moving back to Prince George, and then Jason was born. In Prince George is where he started working in home building construction. As the kids grew older, Uncle Pete moved his family back to Manitoba and settled in the community of Morden, where he watched his children grow. He loved coaching both the kids' baseball teams and attended many school events. When Trish and Stan first got together, Uncle Pete had a new golfing partner, and Stan became obsessed. Uncle Pete enjoyed many golf games, but did you realize he was also a very good bowler? Not only did he bowl, he was a fair baseball player till the age about 45 to 50. Uncle Pete loved doing many activities with kids, from the family road trips to camping. He sure had skill at loading that van for camping. Remember the game Tetris? Well, it was more like camping supplies Tetris. In Morden, he worked building construction homes with Art Stays Construction and then with John Friesen, where he became a subcontractor. He specialized in finishing carpentry in homes that were built. He was very good at his job, and many people knew of his work. Uncle Pete renovated his own home and then went on to build new homes in Morden. He also helped Jason with some projects in home building. When Jason and April first moved to Lethbridge, he moved as well and helped Jason as he started his business and the career of home building. Teaching the skill of carpentry to his son was something he was very proud of. Uncle Pete also helped Trish and Stan build their home in Lethbridge. He loved being around children. What I can remember is he would play catch with all the small children and their parents, and it wasn't baseball. Just envision this. Uncle Pete holding one of my brothers or one of my cousins or even his own child, and there's Uncle Corey. All you could hear is "wee" again from the child as they were being tossed from one uncle to the other uncle. And I'm pretty sure you guys remember that. I believe when Uncle Pete became a grandfather, his love for kids grew stronger. You can find many pictures of him with a grandchild or a niece or nephew on his lap. He always wanted to hold the baby. He loved for his grandchildren was so strong that he built them a wooden rocking horse for the grandkids to play on when they came over. He also built a table and chairs to play, and even a change table, just to mention a few items. As the grandkids grew, so did the activities. It went from jungle gym papa and riding his foot like a horse to card games and listening to country music. Papa loved playing games with the grandkids. Kalia and Callista called him Pretty Pink Princess Papa. He would let the girls put clips in their hair. He paint his nails and put stickers all over him. He loved watching all the grandchildren's activities, whether it was sports, school performances, or even cooking. And of course, we can't forget having family dinners. We all know not to call him late for dinner. All the grandkids know about whisker rubs and tickles, usually right before bed, so they had the warmth of his love to fall asleep to. Jaden is proud to be driving Papa's car today. As you drive, Papa will always be in the passenger seat next to you. Uncle Pete loved to travel, mostly by car. The most memorable trip many can recall is when Uncle Pete and Uncle Jake took their dad on a road trip to Mexico. And on the return home, they stopped at the Cablan Caverns, the caves. he even took his family to Disney World for a month. Yep, they got to be out of school for a month. On holidays, some special holidays were Cancun and Vegas with Trish and Stan. He would quite often surprise his family in Manitoba, making road trips with his fancy blue Mustang to see his siblings and other family. His blue Mustang was famous for racing Uncle Gerald down the highway. Uncle Pete loved his cars, from his little red convertible to the blue Mustang. He would let his siblings learn how to drive using that little red convertible, and he was very proud of this. Lethbridge was home for him. He had many friends that he would meet for coffee at Tim's. This was his coffee crew. Coaldale was another great place for coffee. He would always meet Jason early in the morning at Tim's for a quick one. These encounters, I'm sure, will be missed. Uncle Pete was living close to his family where he could watch them grow. He will be missed for a long time, but we will all have our memories to look back on him. Trish, Dan, Callista, Kalia, Jason, April, Jaden, Emma, and Sarah, your dad, Papa, had a heart of gold and loved you dearly. We are all here to support you, and we always will be. I found a really nice poem that made me think of him that I wanted to share. It's called The Uncle by Nikki Fay. I came into this life, you held me in your arms. You kept me safe so no one could harm. You taught me values, lessons in life I would learn. You taught me to respect. I gave you love in return. You have always been in my life through thick and thin. And now my lonely journey without you will begin. For you were my hero forever and a day. You will always return that hero till I meet you again someday. I will embrace you in my arms and hold you tight. I will stand on by your side and will and you will never leave my sight. I miss you so much, the pain does not ease. I pray you're happy and finally at peace. Thank you.
Now there will be several tributes shared. Some of them will be spoken or read. There will be a photo tribute after that, and then finally a video tribute. So who's ever sharing a tribute, just come forward and boldly share your memories. So the tech crew knows you can go right to the picture tribute followed by the video tribute.
Wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends, and I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places that I've never been, seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Go down the highway.
was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour
If I could have you, I know what I'd do. This time I'd be true. If I had you, if you could be mine, I'd walk that straight line. It'd be no bad times if I had you. I made the worst mistake one fool could ever make. Tell me it's not too late. What can I do? If I could hold you tight, I'd have the world tonight, and everything would be alright if I had you. Thank you.
It's hard to summarize decades of life and impact into a short time, but those were meaningful tributes. Really appreciated you singing Amazing Grace. You should be proud of that. It's a good job. And those, the pictorial and the video tributes as well, just help us capture some of who Peter is and was. And when I met with Peter's family, 2 Corinthians chapter, I believe 3, verses 3 and 4 was suggested for today's service. And I think it's a very appropriate passage. Just listen carefully to these couple of verses. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When we are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. This passage seems to me is particularly appropriate because one of the reasons Paul is writing to the Corinthians, the Christians in Corinth, dovetails with Peter, how he lived his life. We've heard how Pete lived, delighted in seeing his family enjoy moments and activities and succeed at life. This is God's desire for all people. Many in our society present God as a cosmic killjoy who doesn't want people to be successful or joyful. I know at times our children think of us as parents that way too, right? We're only there to put parameters on, but always with the intent of their good and seeing them succeed. And nothing could be further from the truth about God either. He's not there to put parameters on just for the sake of parameters and being mean. It's for our good. Every person is created in the image of God and to some degree reflects his character. One of the main ways Peter shone forth God's character was in his selfless desire for others to do well. I heard how he would go swimming because others enjoyed it. He didn't particularly like camping, but did it for the good of his family. Verse 3 starts with all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is at the beginning of the second letter to the Corinthians. Only the greeting precedes it. And Paul starts with the most important thing, the beginning of beginnings. In the beginning, God created all things, and it was very good, Genesis says. The world was as it was created to be, very good, with no sickness, no sin, selfishness, greed, and many other nasty things, including death. It didn't exist at the beginning. We're here today because people rebelled against God and decided to live in ways they were not created to or designed to. Every person does wrong, sinful, selfish things, and there is sickness and death in our world. Life is way harder than God intended it to be, and there is nothing anyone can do to put things back the way they are supposed to be again, except for one. As this verse says, the Lord Jesus Christ. He came and lived as a man with one dramatic difference from all other people. He never sinned. He never acted selfishly. He never hated. He wasn't jealous or lustful or dishonest in any way, not even once. So he and only he is the way. All creation will be set right side up again. He came so this cycle of sickness and sin and death would not continue endlessly. And he gives every person the choice to continue on our own paths, which lead to death, or to accept his gift of forgiveness and being restored to what we were created for. Wonderful, everlasting life with him in a world that is set right side up again. How did he do this? How is Jesus the way? Well, like Peter chose to swim and camp for the good of others, so Jesus chose to come as a baby. We celebrate this, his coming at Christmas. He chose to live as people were created to live, completely honest and good. He chose to die in our place. See, all people have sinned and done wrong, and this has resulted in death. Jesus came to redeem, to buy back people, so that death does not get the last word. Jesus, through his death and his resurrection, when he came back to life, had victory over death and paid the debt we owed. Indeed, as this verse starts, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Life, true life, life in the full and never ending, is now available to everyone who will accept his gift. Jesus didn't do this because it was fun or enjoyable to die, but for the good of people. Peter lived that out as well. Some of the things he didn't do were fun and enjoyable for him, but he'd do them for those around him. The next sentence of these verses in Corinthians says, God is our merciful Father. Mercy is best described in a story form, I think. Imagine someone coming before a judge. I saw a video years ago, one of those Judge Judy or Judge whatever that's on TV. I saw a little video clip, and there was a young man before the judge. The judge says, did you break into this home and steal? The youth says, well, I helped my neighbor, and I've helped my family. The judge says, did you commit this crime? And it became almost comical that this youth kept pointing out the good things he did, but wouldn't answer the question that the judge was asking him. See, no matter how many good things he did, it didn't change the fact that he was guilty of this crime. We've all lied, stolen, been selfish, and worse. The result is we have earned, by our own choices, living on a path that leads to death. Now, this next part is where mercy steps in. It didn't show up on the video that I watched, but imagine for a moment that either that youth admits his guilt or is proven guilty, and then there's a punishment set. And justice is served, except just before he's taken away, the judge's own son steps forward and says, I'll serve his sentence for him. Not because he deserves it or because he can pay me back in any way. It says here that Jesus is the Son of God, and that's what he did. The God who's a merciful God. Peter delighted in his family, not because you deserved it or could or would or have to earn it from him in some way. You made messes and cost him money. He took his time and energy to provide for you and to play with you. And he didn't keep a record of it, how much you could owe him back at some time, as if you could ever do that. He was your father, your grandfather, and it was his pleasure to see you do well. Oh, he didn't do things perfectly or unselfishly all the time, I'm sure. Any more than we do. I've had to apologize to my sons many times for how I overreacted or acted harshly or selfishly in a moment. But Peter, like all people, reflected God's character to some degree because we're created in God's image. And so he could act with self-sacrifice and loving service. And what is the way this passage talks about that God serves those who trust him? Comfort. These verses go on. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He gets it better than we do, how twisted and distorted our world is and how much harder it is than it was designed to be. And he comforts better than anyone else. I think of a girl who was deeply distressed and even depressed after her fiance broke up with her. And he called off the wedding. Her family, and particularly her dad, stepped in there, let her and helped her grieve, and acknowledged that it was over, and face this new reality. And he and the rest of her family helped her see that she was more than a woman waiting to be married. She was a daughter, an aunt, a friend, and had many other people and meaningful relationships. Her life was much more than only in relation to her now ex-boyfriend and ex-fiancé. Verse 4 says, he comforts us all in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. When we allow, like this young woman did, allow God to comfort us and lead us on a journey toward greater health and health in the fullest sense, we are better image bearers and we are able to comfort others as well. As we reflect on Peter's life and these couple of verses from 2 Corinthians, let's commit to and encourage each other to receive God's work and comfort in our lives. And the result will be that we are more able to live like we were created to, and able to comfort and care for others as we have been comforted and cared for. Please join me in a word of prayer. Thank you, Jesus, that you are not selfish at all, but rather completely selfless. Thank you for how Peter reflected your character and was concerned for the joy and well-being of others. We ask you to lead every person through healthy grief into meaningful relationships with you and other people. And God, comfort as only you can, God. Comfort through your Spirit, through your Word, through your people. Empower us to be more accurate reflections of your character so that we can in turn comfort those around us in this harsh world. And I restate the verses as a prayer. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When we are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. Thank you for these truths. Thank you for Peter's life. We thank you in your name. Amen. As you think about life and the journey we're on, continue to think about that. There's going to be another song played. It's a song called The Old Rugged Cross, as it tells a story as it goes along. Just think about these things.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. And I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To that old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish
see your rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. Yeah, I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. This
concludes this portion of the service. I will end with a closing prayer, and now I'll ask you to stand for that. Actually, if you can stand now, we will conclude with prayer and then follow the family out. But I'll just remind you, there's a display at the back, and if you would like to share a story or a memory with the family, there's some sheets back there. You can fill that out. We are going to proceed out here and directly out to the cemetery with the family. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you. All praise to you, God, and Jesus. You've accomplished this. Death does not get the final word. For everyone who receives your gift decides to live as we're created to. Relationship with you, with each other, there's eternal, everlasting life. We thank you for this. Thank you for Peter's life. Would you go with us from here? Continue to comfort and transform us. Thank you. We ask it in your name, Jesus. Amen.